People like to complain that I don't have enough Republicans on, so here they are. Please welcome the host of HLN's Essie Cupp Unfiltered and CNN political commentator, Essie Cupp. And 2016 independent presidential candidate and founder of Stand Up Republic, Evan McMullin. Thank you guys for coming on the show.
Thanks for having us. Yeah. It's nice to represent Republicans.
Yeah, right. Is it?
In Los Angeles. No, it's not, actually, it's not.
Okay, so let's talk about the Republican Party. Let's talk about a couple of like the most recent events. I know it's really hard to keep up in this cycle of news, obviously. Congratulations on your new show, by the
Thank
way.
Thank you.
Yeah, yes. Yeah. Let's show a clip of what Steve Bannon, a little bit of a 60 Minutes interview real quick.
The Republican establishment is trying to nullify the 2016 election. That's a brutal fact we have to face.
The Republican establishment.
The Republican establishment
wants to nullify the 2016 election.
Trying to nullify the 2016 election. Okay. Absolutely.
Who?
I think Mitch McConnell and to a degree Paul Ryan. They do not want Donald Trump's populist, economic, nationalist agenda to be implemented. It's very obvious. It's obvious as night follows day.
Why does everything he does have to be so creepy? You know, like he can make a point and then he just sounds like Darth Vader at the end of it.
Right.
What are your thoughts on Steve Bannon? Well, Evan, let's start with you.
Well, I think that he is Donald Trump's, he's an advocate for Donald Trump's populism, as we just heard there. But I think when he starts to talk about the Republican establishment or the establishment wanting to nullify the election, really what he's talking about is what he calls the deep state. And that's a euphemism for really the government, the checks and balances that we have in our government, holding Donald Trump accountable. Our government, in many ways, is doing what it was intended to do, which is to hold a president like Donald Trump accountable. Obviously, there's more I would like to see done. But he paints that as a diabolical thing. It's not. It's actually the way our government is supposed to work.
Right. Okay. And what do you think about him?
Well, I said it during the campaign, and I've said it since. Donald Trump really wore the Republican Party like a rented tuxedo to become president. And he didn't really believe in the party. He doesn't really know what conservatism is writ large. And when he became president, you know, the tuxedo's in the corner, crumpled, stained. And so now the party is left sort of figuring out who we are and where we go. And Steve Bannon is wrestling with same things that Paul Ryan and Mitch McConnell are wrestling with. Where are we? Who are we? Mm-hmm. And the center of gravity right now is not with Republicans or the party. I mean, look, we've got Republicans in House, Senate, White House, and a majority of state houses. And yet, never before in modern history have I seen the Republican Party less influential, more irrelevant. The center of gravity is with Donald Trump. Mm-hmm. So that's why you're seeing some of this hand-wringing in Congress, among the Steve Bannon sort of Breitbart wing, because they're all trying to figure out, who are we? What do we stand for? Do we stand for Donald Trump, or do we stand for the stuff we used to stand for before he was in the White House?
And do you think that he's more powerful, Steve Bannon, out of the White House? Because it feels like, I think he is. He's going to get a lot more done with what he wants to do. You know, by being able, you know, he's a freer person outside of the White House.
Well, absolutely. So he's now freed up to be a stronger advocate for populism outside of the White House than he was inside the White House. So populism is the philosophy of a lot of authoritarians and dictators around the world. It's this fundamentally the idea that what's popular is right. That means minority rights get sort of lost or threatened in that mix. And so and leaders are less accountable. It's a very dangerous idea.
But it's also going in with that theory. Donald Trump is not popular. You know, he's got his base, but he's not popular in this country. Mm-hmm. So how does the populism translate to his presidency?
Well, it starts at some place and then it can grow, and that's the problem. So you saw during the election that some Democratic voters, historically Democratic voters, voted for Trump. They came across the aisle, they voted for Trump. That's where it begins. And you see a populist movement on the left as well. On the far left, Bernie Sanders, real socialism on the left. Those things are reshaping American politics. And by the way, they're pulling both parties further to the extreme. And those of us in the current middle, and that's most of America, we are now sort of left without party representation.
Yeah, I mean, that's how Democrats feel too, I think. There's like a lack of leadership, definitely. So what do you think about the rumors about like Mitch McConnell and Ryan, Paul Ryan being replaced? Because Paul Ryan can be replaced as Speaker of the House, right? They can pick anybody to be the Speaker of the House.
Yep.
They don't even have to be a congressman, right?
That's right.
Right. I don't see that happening. I think ultimately, as you said, the checks and balances of the separate but co-equal branches of government will keep someone like Paul Ryan in place and probably Mitch McConnell as well. And actually,
do you like
having,
those guys? Do you like Paul Ryan and Mitch McConnell?
I like Paul Ryan a lot, Mitch McConnell a little bit less, but I voted for Paul Ryan for president. That worked out.
Yeah.
But
congratulations on
thanks,
that.
Thanks, I feel good about
it. And now you can congratulate me on mine.
Yeah, right.
Thanks, by the way, ladies.
I know,
thanks
sorry.
A lot. Thanks a lot.
You wrote a great piece about being like, you know, not voting for Hillary, being a female Republican, and how lonely it is.
It was.
And but so who did you vote for, Evan?
No.
Clearly not.
Ryan,
yeah.
No.
He wasn't running.
Oh,
by the
this
way.
Election?
I know.
Yeah. Paul Ryan was running.
No,
oh,
he
you
wasn't.
Just filled in his name.
You know, I needed to sleep at night. I needed to be able to tell my 2-year-old in 20 years that I was on the side of the good and the right, and that I had some principles in this, and it was a personal decision for me, and everyone votes, you know, for whomever they want, and that's fine, no judgment. But I do like Paul Ryan, and I think he's a necessary check against the executive, and I think if it's not necessarily a bad thing that all of these entities are kind of in consternation with each other. Government should, by its nature, be slow and cumbersome, and people should be debating it all the time, and even intra-party, there should be debates about especially big pieces of legislation. I don't like when government's fast and big and all at once. So I'm not all that mad about the infighting. I just wish that the Republican Party wasn't shape-shifting, as it were, into something else just because there's an R in the White House named Donald Trump.
But that shape-shifting, though, I do believe puts especially Paul Ryan at risk. And the reason for that is we've heard several moderate Republicans in the House have announced that they're not going to run for office again.
Yeah.
And so what you're going to see after the 2018 midterm elections is a Republican Party, at least its representation in the House, is going to be far more Trumpian than it is now. And that fact will end up putting immense pressure and even create a threat for Paul Ryan's speakership.
But can you blame them? Who would want to go into politics right now?
Well, I would argue that
you have to go into
politics
right now if you're ever going to go in.
If you care,
but
I mean, it's so gross.
But I would argue that you have to care. I would argue that you have to get involved. I don't want to fucking read this shit every day.
No kidding.
You know what I mean? It's exhausting.
But what can you get done? What's the incentive? Where do you work? Who do you work with? I mean, I heard Mitt Romney is thinking of running for Senate in Utah. Mm-hmm. Why?
Why are you not a fan of his?
What? No, I adore him. He's fantastic. That's why I want to save him from this mistake. I mean, what can you do in the Senate? The Senate has the least, I mean, there's no real power in the Senate. The Senate's where you go to pretend to have power.
Well, that's
I don't
funny
know.
Because
I mean,
Evan was just about to announce his run for the Senate.
Exactly.
Oh, good luck.
I would, look, the
you
Senate.
You're going to run for something at some point.
I will likely pursue public office again. I'm looking at a couple of things. I don't know when it's going to be.
Well, you found your campaign manager.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, right.
Essie's a big fan, so. No,
you know
look,
I am.
Look,
I
think there's actually a lot one can do in the Senate. I mean, you're one of 100. One vote in the Senate, and especially a divided Senate, is a ton of power to do good with. So,
you know, it really could be.
It could be.
But it's not right now, because not fixing shit is too politically profitable. And that's the sad truth that no one will tell you.
That's right.
When you fix immigration, you can't run on it, and you can't campaign on it. You can't fundraise off it. When you fix stuff, you lose the ability to actually win elections. And that is the sad truth, and it's true on both parties. Mm-hmm. So I love this optimism. Mm-hmm. I really do. But now does not feel like the time to actually get stuff done.
Well, and I think what I'm hearing from a lot of people, and I think Essie's comments reflect this, is that, yes, things aren't getting done. We're frustrated. But at the same time, you see both parties moving towards the extreme, which makes it even more difficult to get things done. Which means you can't get things done without enormous cost to yourself politically. Mm-hmm. And so what I believe needs to happen is we in this country have got to strengthen in the center. whether you're a Republican or a Democrat, if you're a sort of a mainstream American who believes in equality, the equality of all, who believes in liberty, that we should be free, that our government is accountable to us, these basic things, we need to band together. It doesn't mean change your party affiliation necessarily, but we need to realize that we have more in common in the center than we do with the extremes, whichever party you belong to.
Okay, so that's very well said. Thank you. Also, let's talk about Russia real quick. How do you see this playing out? I mean, I think, I really feel in my bones that Donald Trump and his whole family is going down. And I want it to be true, but I don't know if it's really true. But I think it's true. I mean, this investigation is just, there's too many things going on and it never dies. And when things don't die, rumors don't die, they're true, usually.
Right, well, I would say, look, I will be surprised if nothing legally comes of this. There's just so much, whether it's financial, business-related crimes before the campaign, collusion during the campaign, or obstruction of justice after the campaign. I find it hard to believe that nothing for anyone of the Trump organization comes of this. But I will say this, that's the legal stuff, and I'm not an attorney. I think the more serious question is how we look at this politically. We have, as American citizens, have a decision to make here. Are we going to stand by and let politicians and leaders clearly cooperate on some level with a foreign power to sort of rob our ability to choose our own leaders or to be manipulated by foreign powers? Is that acceptable to us? Well, no matter what happens legally, this cannot be politically acceptable to us, and we cannot tolerate our leaders doing this, and those who do need to be rejected and voted out of office.
This used to be a Republican thing, by the way. I mean, we used to be real scared of Russia. You remember, Mitt Romney called Russia our number one geopolitical foe. Now, among many other things, it seems to be the thing that Trump Republicans, at least, are saying, not such a big deal anymore.
Right. Well, thank you guys both for being here. Hopefully more Republicans will come on my show. You can come. Hey. You're welcome.
The water's warm.
Oh, hello. You caught me here in the middle of my own talk show, talking on my show. I hope you enjoyed whatever video of mine you just watched. I know I did. If you want to see more, you can click on that subscribe button, which is, I don't know where it is, but find a button and then click on it, and then just keep clicking, and then suck on that. Okay. Oh, hello.